Good morning and welcome to the parishes of St Patrick's in Armoy, Drumtulla and All Saints in Lough Gill. Wherever you're joining us from, and I know some of you join us from faraway places, you're very welcome and may you know the peace and presence of God as we worship this morning. Please tell your family members and your friends and your neighbours that this service is available for them on YouTube. All they have to do is log into YouTube and then click on the appropriate link, having searched for St Pat's Armoy. If you want to keep up to date with everything that's going on locally, please check out our Facebook page. And currently we have a new series of thoughts and meditations under the heading of Moments with God. You might find these helpful. So have a wee look at those each day. May they be your sustenance and your help for the day ahead. We're going to be looking at what Jesus means when he says that the kingdom of God is at hand. But before we get that length, our service is morning prayer. And if you're following at home in your prayer books, then it's on page 101. And we begin with a word of scripture from John's Gospel, chapter 15, verse 8. It says, "This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples." But let's begin by greeting each other in the Lord's name. The Lord be with you. Beloved in Christ, we come together to offer to Almighty God our worship and praise and thanksgiving, to confess our sins and to receive God's forgiveness, to hear his holy word proclaimed and to bring before him our needs and the needs of the world, and to pray in the power of his Spirit that we may serve him and know the greatness of his love. So before we say the words of the confession together, which you'll find on page 102, let's take a moment to reflect in silence upon how this week has worked out and ask God through his Spirit to bring to mind all those things that shouldn't have been a part of that week and that we need to be saying sorry to him for now. We do that in our own time. The psalmist reminds us that the sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit and a contrite heart. So let us come before Almighty God, broken and in sorrow, as we confess our sins to him. Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, by what we have done and by what we have failed to do. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that has passed, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth will proclaim your praise. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Praise the Lord. The Lord's name be praised. We're going to praise God in song, first of all by singing a hymn. It's going to come up on your screen, and it invites God to come and speak into our hearts and into our lives. Speak, O Lord.
Speak. speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith. Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us all your purposes for your glory. Cause our faith to rise, cause our eyes to see your majestic love and authority. Words of power that can never fail, let the truth prevail.
Continue to worship God using some of the words from the Herbs Fortitudinis, which is based upon words that we find in Scripture in Isaiah in chapter 26. We're going to say these words together. We'll put them up on the screen. We have a strong city. He sets up salvation as walls and bulwarks. Open the gates that the righteous nation which keeps faith may enter in. You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you, because he trusts in you. Trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord God is an everlasting rock. The way of the righteous is level. You who are upright make smooth the path of the righteous. In the path of your judgments, O Lord, we wait for you. Your name and renown is the desire of our soul. My soul yearns for you in the night. My spirit within me earnestly seeks you. For when your judgments are in the earth, the inhabitants of the world learn righteousness. O Lord, you will ordain peace for us, for indeed all that we have done, you have done for us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Our reading comes from Mark's Gospel, chapter 1, beginning at verse 14. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God, and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, brother Andrew cast in a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And as he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat, mending their nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. This is the word of the Lord. Heavenly Father, we turn aside from our own thoughts and from the world around us to reflect upon your word, the word which we have shared together. We pray now for help to understand it. May your Holy Spirit come upon us. May he open our hearts and our lives and speak into our minds. Help us to receive what you have to say with eagerness and gladness, and show us how we can best put it into practice every day for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. Most of you who are listening to this live in the United Kingdom, and as such you're familiar with what it is to live under a monarchy. We are governed by Queen Elizabeth, who happens to be a constitutional monarch, which means she in reality has very little say or little power. But did you know that there are lots of other countries in the world that are also called kingdoms? Perhaps you know some of these, perhaps it didn't occur to you. But we have the Kingdom of Belgium, the Kingdom of Bhutan, of Saudi Arabia, of Cambodia, of Bahrain, the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan, the Kingdom of Morocco, the Kingdom of Norway, and I could go on a little more. Some of those kingdoms have kings ruling over them, others queens. Some have sultans, some have emperors, some have emirs. Some are hereditary rulers, some are elected. Some are also constitutional leaders with only ceremonial duties. Others are absolute rulers and rule with an iron fist. And although each of these setups, each of these kingdoms are similar, they're also very different. But they do bear one resemblance, one with another, and that is that they're all visible. They are easily defined. You can see each of these kingdoms on a map. You can trace the outline with your finger. You could go and walk around the boundaries of those kingdoms if you so chose. In our reading, Jesus speaks to us about the kingdom of God. He says, "The time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel." The kingdom is a big theme for Jesus. It's mentioned in the Gospels about 126 times. But ask the question, what is the kingdom of God, and try and define it? Well, that's more difficult. It's certainly much more difficult than trying to define a geographical earthly kingdom like the United Kingdom, for example. So what did Jesus mean when he said that The kingdom of God is at hand. Different people have come up with different thoughts. Some think that the kingdom is what's inside your heart. Other people have suggested that the kingdom of God is the church and what God does through his church in the world. And others have suggested that the kingdom of God is in heaven and not on earth at all. Well, what we do know is that the kingdom of God is not a physical place. It's not a physical entity. Because when we read about the kingdom of God in the Bible, what we discover most readily is that the kingdom of God is a whole lot, not so much about territory, but about the rule of God. It's about his reign. It's about his actions. It's about his lordship. It's about his sovereign governance. So, in a sense, it would be perfectly justified for me to say that the kingdom of God is present whenever you proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord. Whenever you submit to the rule of Christ's authority over your life, the kingdom of God is present there. In other words, the kingdom of God is found wherever God reigns, wherever God is allowed to reign. So the kingdom of God, therefore, can be found in your heart, it can be found in your living room, or in your church, or in your schoolroom, or in your workplace. It can be found on your lips, through your speech, in your actions. The kingdom of God is found and proclaimed wherever God is allowed to reign. But one of the features of the kingdom of God is that it needs to be received. And Jesus teaches us that quite simply the kingdom of God needs to be received like a little child with simple trust. A few years ago I was walking with Gillian past the convention centre that overlooks the River Liffey in Dublin, and just as we were walking past, a large crowd tumbled out of the building, having just attended an Irish citizenship ceremony. It was a mixture of people, obviously from different backgrounds and different nationalities and parts of the world. And at that ceremony, the candidates would have had to have sworn an oath of fidelity to the nation of Ireland, and then they would have received a certificate of naturalisation, and they would have become citizens of Ireland. But what struck me about it was that it was their choice to do that. It is something that they decided to do. They decided, for whatever reason, to leave the country of their birth and come and live and work in Ireland, and then they choose to become Irish citizens. They couldn't have simply drifted into becoming Irish citizens. Just by living and working within the boundaries of Ireland didn't automatically make them citizens. And so becoming a citizen of the kingdom of God is not automatic either. To become a citizen of the kingdom of God, you have first to become a child of God. And in order for that to happen, we've got to be born again, because none of us are automatically born into God's family. Instead of being born automatically as children of God, in Ephesians 2:3, Paul tells us that we are naturally born children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. But when we are born again, that is when we are saved. We've come to put our hope and our trust in Jesus Christ. At that point, God adopts us as his children and we become citizens of heaven. But that required us to make a choice. You must choose to be a citizen of the kingdom of heaven, just as you must choose to be a city of any country, as a citizen of any country that you adopt as your own. And then, having chosen to become a citizen, you must meet the requirements to get you to that position. And it's exactly the same for the kingdom of God. We've got to choose to want to be citizens of the kingdom of God. Then we've got to submit to the entry requirements. And the entry requirements, as Scripture lays out for us, is belief in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and repentance of your sin. And both John the Baptist and Jesus preached this. The time has come, they said. The kingdom of God has come near. So repent and believe the good news. That those are the entry requirements into the kingdom of heaven that make you citizens of that kingdom. When you become a citizen of any country, there are implications for you. In a broad sense, there are always implications that you will work and you will pay tax on your earnings. There are implications that you will be a law-abiding citizen, that you will keep the law, you will act lawfully, that you will live in peace. And if you're called to defend your country, you will be willing to do that. The kingdom of God holds implications for its citizens as well. As believers in Christ, there are implications, there are expectations that we will worship him, that we will revere him as Lord and Savior, that that won't be a superficial act that happens from time to time, but that it will be an ongoing daily offering of witness and service and worship through everything that we are and have, do and think and say. There is an expectation that we would cease chasing our own hopes, plans and dreams and put them into subservience behind God's plans and desires for our lives, recognizing his reign over us, that he is sovereign over us. There's an implication too, an expectation that we will go on to live out all of Christ's teachings in our daily lives as we anticipate his return. When Jesus taught his disciples to pray, part of that directive was to pray that God's kingdom would come to fruition here on earth. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That is our purpose, to glorify God by praying in his kingdom, by exhibiting his kingdom, by proclaiming his kingdom, by living his kingdom on a daily basis. While the kingdom of God has already been established on earth, it hasn't yet been made complete. And so we are to continue to work and pray for the coming of the fullness of that kingdom. Because as members of that kingdom, we've been given a job. We are ambassadors to the King. We are ambassadors for God on this earth. And our role as ambassadors is to proclaim the good news of the kingdom of God to others. This is the great commission that we all sit under. This is God's expectation for us. And you know, we should do that with an ever increasing sense of urgency, because God's patience with the world one day is going to run out. It's going to come to an end and Christ will return, but this time not to redeem us, but to be our judge. We need people to understand that. We need people to hear that God loves them and longs for them to be his adopted children and citizens of heaven. He wants to redeem them and include them in his kingdom. John Calvin said it was the task of the visible church to make the invisible kingdom known. And we do that in such a way that we bear witness to the reality of the kingship of Jesus Christ in our lives. Wherever we find ourselves, in our workplaces, in our families, in our schools, with our credit cards, in our conversations, in our nights out, in our rest and relaxation, in our hobbies, in every sphere of life. The only way the kingdom of God is going to be manifest in the world before Christ comes is if we manifest it by the way we live as citizens of heaven and subjects of the King. If you would turn Please, to page 112 in your prayer book, you will see the words of the Apostles' Creed. It summarizes all the things that we believe. We're going to say these things together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. We pray as Jesus taught us, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. O Lord, save the Queen and grant her government wisdom. Let your ministers be clothed with righteousness, and let your servants shout for joy. O Lord, save your people and bless those whom you have chosen. Give peace in our time, O Lord, and let your glory be over all the earth. O God, make clean our hearts within us and renew us by your Holy Spirit. The Collect of the Third Sunday after the Epiphany. Almighty God, whose Son revealed in signs and miracles the wonders of your saving presence, renew your people with your heavenly grace, and in all our weakness, sustain us by your mighty power, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Bountiful God, through your Son, you have called us to repent of our sin, to believe the good news, and to celebrate the coming of your kingdom. Teach us, like Christ's first apostles, to hear the call to discipleship, and forsaking old ways, to proclaim the gospel of new life to a broken world, through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Heavenly Father, thank you that you are King over all, the creator and sustainer of all things. There is no one like you, supreme in authority, all-seeing, all-knowing, all-wise, completely just and fair, righteous in all things. Thank you that even though you are God of all, you are also merciful, extending undeserved grace to us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord God, we bow before you. We submit to your lordship. We proclaim you King over our lives. We pray for the kingdom and lands filled with trouble, for countries at war with their neighbors, for countries facing internal unrest, for lands divided by race, politics, color, or creed, for lands laid low through economic hardship, unemployment, and for countries oppressed by tyrants. Lord God, ruler of all, who works out your purposes through those you raise in authority over us, bring stability and peace, hope and healing to the broken nations of the world, and extend the rule over your kingdom over all the earth. We pray for childlike faith to trust you through the highs and lows of life, that we might live as citizens of heaven, giving honour and glory to you in this world, and looking forward to our home in heaven. Help us to be builders of your kingdom, filled with your Holy Spirit and dependent upon you, ambassadors representing you faithfully and in all truth. We pray for our community, for those who are sick with COVID and those recovering from it, for those whose daily work exposes them to danger, for those whose treatment has been delayed because of the congestion in our hospitals, for those who may die alone, and for those who are feeling increasingly isolated and vulnerable. Lord God, King over all, comfort the bereaved and anxious. Hold the frightened, lead the lost, feed the hungry, protect the weak and vulnerable, and may your name be lifted high and all honour and glory be ascribed to you forever and ever. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. And we say the words of the third collect together as we pray for God to go with us and to help us to be his disciples and to bear fruit for his kingdom. Go before us, Lord, in all our doings with your most gracious favour, and further us with your continual help, that in all our works begun, continued and ended in you, we may glorify your holy name, and finally, by your mercy, attain everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And we pray for ourselves and for one another in the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. And so we sing our second and final hymn that reminds us of the hope we have in Jesus. The Lord is my salvation.
Reached for me and pulled me from a raging sea, and I am safe on this solid ground. The Lord is my salvation. I will not fear when darkness falls. His strength will help me scale these walls. I'll see the dawn of the rising sun. The Lord is my salvation. His grace will renew these days. The Lord is my salvation. Who is my final day. He will not leave me at the grave, but I will rise. He will call me.
And so may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and those whom you love, today and always. Amen.